Welcome, everyone, to the first episode of Freestyle, the show with no rules and no limits. Every episode, Firebird Productions is going to bring you something new, fresh, and exciting. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Freestyle. Here's a look at the construction at Free State from Katie Diaz and Isabel Jansen.
On September 25th, 2017, the Lawrence School Board of Education approved construction for Free State, Lawrence High, and other USD 497 schools. Last summer, Free State's 2018-2019 construction began. In December, additions to the east wing of the school were completed with 7 new classrooms and a cardio room on the opposite end of the school. In January, the media construction stage began. Walls were built on the second floor and in the commons to separate the students from construction. Walking through the walls in the media center, you'll be able to see the learning staircase and new staircases leading into the media center. Students will be able to eat lunch and hang out on the new staircase. The media center will be at the top of the staircase, and there'll be plenty of space in the library to work and study. There'll be 4 learning pockets in the library, a station for the tech guy, a genius bar, and also a station for our librarians. The media center is set to be done around April 1st, so the librarians can start moving stuff around May 1st. Behind the media center will be 14 new gender-neutral bathrooms. It may seem like there's a lot of commotion going on at Free State, but before you know it, we'll be in a beautiful, brand new school.
We now present a D&D Club highlight from Riley Bradamus and Brock Cordova.
Hi, I'm here with Mr. Lloyd, and he is the sponsor for D&D Club.
Let's take a break from this interview and follow a truly fascinating journey of a young lad getting acquainted with one of Free State's many clubs. He seems to be pondering what he should do, but he's heard of a place that he believes will be lots of fun.
So it's basically students in small groups playing a sort of a board game, but it's more a role-playing game or a game where you use your imagination more and run through different scenarios and settings.
Ah, yes, D&D Club, a wonderful club. Now we will see the amazing time this young lad will have in today's meeting.
Really, the first thing you would do if you were a new member is make a character and then join a campaign. And campaign is something that makes sense to young people, like in a video game or something like that.
This club not only plays Dungeons & Dragons, but it also has students who play a similar game called Pathfinder. And even if you don't play that, some students use that time to play on their Nintendo Switches, or even just hang out.
Student interaction is a lot of times hilarious or loud or kind of comical, because they will have their characters in the Dungeons & Dragons game. They'll have their characters do unpredictable or funny or exciting things to run through the scenario, and they'll sort of get out of character themselves and into their character they're playing with, and so their interactions are pretty exciting, pretty fun.
Yes, spontaneous and fun indeed.
So I sponsored Dungeons & Dragons last year, and then this year also, and last year was co-sponsored with Beth Shirley. And this year is just sponsoring just my own.
Mr. Lloyd is not new to this club. He knows what he's doing.
I think D&D Club has been going on for a long time. The school opened in 97, I guess, or 98. And I would say there's probably been a D&D Club since then, I would guess.
Just look. They have had so much time to perfect their efficiency and intensity of their games.
We meet every other Wednesday, 2:30 to 4:30, and there's a Discord, which is a messaging app, whatever, and they do some announcements on there so they can communicate and know when we have club, and Every other Wednesday, and new players are welcome, or players who have played 100 times are welcome.
Looks like this cool bunch is just about done with their session.
This has been Mr. Lloyd with his run on D&D Club. Thank you.
Cheers.
Let's check in with the young lad. It seems Mr. Lloyd has noticed his new member and is welcoming him to the club. Now, young lad, how was D&D Club today?
That was great.
Hi, Free State. We had a lot of fun making this segment about D&D Club, and we found that the people were nice to work with. If you're interested in joining, talk to Mr. Lloyd or another club member about when they meet up next. The club meetings are held after school every other Wednesday. Come see what they have in store in room 204.
Kate Bartle, Hope Gregory, and Audrey Gutierrez went and got some style tips from the icon himself, Mr. Myron Graber.
Sure, I think they're fun. Why not?
Do you recognize what these are?
What is that, like a blow dryer or something? What is that?
They're AirPods.
Oh, okay. Now I see what you got. Okay, AirPods. Overdone. Very stylish. Very popular. I see lots of those. So pretty cool, yeah. I thought those were gone.
Well.
Yeah, I haven't seen those for a while, so I would say probably hide it somewhere in the closet. I can't believe people are still wearing those, especially in the wintertime. Not a fan of those. Yeah, they're kind of old school in a way.
Yeah.
They kind of retro back a little bit. So, yeah, they're pretty cool. It's kind of like the old Adidas.
Right.
Yeah, they're cool. I like them. Yeah, I think that would be... Yeah, I'd wear one. I heard of the Supreme, but I'm not a fan of fanny packs either, so
okay.
I'm not sure why. But
wearing striped shirts, and then you wear a t-shirt over it.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's a good look.
Right.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of hoodies.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think sweatshirts are overdone, maybe. Ruined a good pair of jeans.
Okay. What style trends were popular when you were in high school?
We had the Converse tennis shoes that you see are kind of popular now. There was a time when there were bell bottoms, plaids, t-shirts were out. You never wore a t-shirt. You never wore a hoodie. Girls wore a lot of skirts.
Would you consider wearing any of these things that you saw today?
I wear a hoodie, some of the Champion sweatshirt. I'd never wear a fanny pack. Okay, so. The acid wash jeans, I'd probably wear them, you know, so, yeah.
Mitchell Spriggs dove deep into the wild of Lawrence, Kansas, and what he found was an extraordinary act of nature.
Welcome to In the Wild. Today, we're going to be learning about some incredible creatures. These animals are amazing in all their glory, and most people don't understand.
Of course, we are talking about a unique group of humans, a polar vortex of humans, if you will. This category of Homo sapiens have come to be known as Homo sapiens cultus legis, or those who are wearing shorts in the wintertime. I like to call them polar sapiens.
Let's find out more about these animals, shall we?
We find ourselves today in a common feeding and activity ground where the polar sapiens work and play. Its habitat consists of few fellow polar sapiens, as well as other more common Homo sapiens. This is where all of these creatures learn and acquire future survival skills. What is it about these polar sapiens that cause or allow them to ignore the harsh climate?
I don't think so. I think it's hypothermia waiting to happen. Well, they're not hairy enough for that. You know, I see all these bare legs out there, and they've got to be cold. Well, I think this frontal lobe part of their brain isn't developed well enough, that or it's just got frostbite in there or something. frostbite, perhaps, of the frontal lobe.
The polar sapiens seem to be non-violent towards the other animals. This may be because they are friendly, or maybe this is a place where all these animals can come together in relative harmony.
Well, from a psychological perspective, I would say that yes, it is interesting in that not all people do this. So we could look at something like motivation and see why individuals might be engaging in this type of behavior, or we could look at what might actually be happening in their biology that would make them want to wear shorts in the winter.
often the polar sapiens like to hang with others of its kind. As you can see, we have found a group of them just what looks like communicating with one another. Common Homo sapiens are more susceptible this time of year to cold and influenza. What might the ramifications be of their ignoring the winter climate?
I think that we have a lot of students that are addicted to their shorts and comfort, and they don't want to change that regardless of the weather.
I hope today we have shed some light on these unique creatures. Perhaps we have learned that it is better to leave them alone and live in peace.
Is pineapple good on pizza? Producer Alyssa Hess pulled the students of Free State to find out.
One's passion for pizza is not to be underestimated. Sauce has been spilled in all kinds of debates. Chicago deep dish over to New York thin crust. Frozen over fresh. Yet nothing seems to divide pizza aficionados like Hawaiian pizza, a conventional pie topped with perceived obscenities such as pineapple. For one thing, it's not even Hawaiian in origin. For another, putting fruit on a pizza has been compared to doodling on the Mona Lisa. So, in honor of National Pizza Week, we're taking a quick look at the origins of this controversial addition to the menu. For centuries, or at least since the 1960s, it's been a hotly debated topic. Not global warming or even cloning. I'm talking pineapple on pizza. Hold on, being told it's not National Pizza Week. So what do people in this part of the world think?
It's so good. Absolutely not.
You're eating my home! Hawaiian pizzas were actually invented by a Canadian. Probably as a joke. Seriously, Hawaiian pizza actually originated in Ontario, Canada in the 1960s, when satellite restaurant owner and Greek immigrant Sam Panopoulos returned from Detroit, having sampled what was then a novelty for Canadians, pizza. At the time, pizza, as a dough and sauce arrangement, was considered an ethnic food and not widely available in the country. Inspired in part by his experience preparing Chinese dishes, which commonly mix sweet and savory flavors, Panopoulos took what he'd learned from his stateside visit, bought a small oven, and began preparing pizzas with toppings like mushroom, bacon, and pepperoni. All good things. So where did it all go wrong? Panopoulos soon experimented with adding pineapple and ham to his pizzas. Not surprisingly, this wasn't initially very popular. But soon, word got around, and Hawaiian pizza became popular locally and eventually became a staple offering of pizzerias around the world. In Australian slang, to get the wrong end of the pineapple means to get a bad deal. Literally translated to, bad deal pizza, you bloody drongo. So take all of this in the spirit which it's intended. It's very tongue or pineapple in cheek. Even the worst pizza is better than practically anything else. So if you like or love pineapple on pizza, you're still a good person, I guess. Just make sure to eat it far, far away from me, because it's just wrong.
Finally, a short-length feature from Hank Hurst, Where's the Chew? Thank you.